The meadow in which the the wilderness I'm talking about. So you have wildernesses within the cages, within the open moat areas, as well as outside. And those are the areas which actually attract a huge number of wild birds also. So you come to the zoo and you think you are just visiting a city, menagerie, a cage with animals that you captive, and you can see, take a walk around, see the animals and go. But here I want to emphasize that the zoo is just not a zoo. But if you think, just imagine, this is the zoo, that's the Miralam Dam, and see the sea of humanity all around. There's hardly any human. This is not agricultural field. That's the river, and the two big tanks are further up. But all these little green patches you see are not really greenery that will take care of such a lot of population. So I consider the zoo as a green lung, of course, which also Mr. Pushpakumar developed it as. And he said in the future this will be a green lung for the city, and that's what it is. It breathes, it clears the air so that so many people can get at least some fresh air. Otherwise it is a cesspool of pollution, this entire area. Now the zoo has, we've grown up with the zoo, we've been built up as amateur naturalists because of the zoo. And these are some of the activities we used to do. This is a picture from the 80s, where, you know, with Doug, we were part of the Nature Clubs of India movement, and how this is how the Nature Clubs of India used to not only talk about wildlife, but also attract other people. So we had a sale of products, we used to talk about what wildlife is and why you should, people should become members of the World Wildlife Fund. The zoo provided provided an opportunity for people to learn about wildlife which is not captive in the zoo, but which exists in the wild, in India. And of course, bird watching. The Bird Watchers Society of Andhra Pradesh used to conduct annual or more frequent visits in the zoo. And here you can see Mr. Pushpakumar is here. And he is also, he was Mr. Puresh in the zoo. I think he is that person. And people are going around in the zoo at that time. I think it was a greener zoo at that time with more trees. But with more enclosures being added later on, trees were thinned out. I'll talk about that a little later. But you see, it's like they're walking in a forest. You see the habitat. Now, why do you have a diversity of birds? Why do you have a diversity of smaller animal life or of even mammals? There should be a diversity of habitats. And the zoo within its very small area of 350 acres, or a huge area of 380 acres as you want to view it, has this great mixture of patchwork of habitats which encourages a lot of wildlife to thrive. Birds, of course, are there. There are about 170 species on my list just from the zoo. But I'm sure there is a large number of insect life, this reptile life, and even small mammals. I don't think there are surveys done of small mammals living in the wild in the zoo, but I'm certain there are several species, at least, because squirrels, we've got noruses, we might have a hare, I don't know, a porcupine, which is white. And who knows, there might be civet cats also. I mean, you are the people who should actually ask for light surveys where you go around with torches and, you know, flash them into trees and see if there are any eyes shining back at you, and those will be civet cats, maybe. So the zoo is this fantastic place within the city, within reach of everybody, that we can, you know, actually use to hone our skills as budding naturalists. So that's what I'm talking about. It's a quick work of habitat, it's a patchwork of habitat. We have open, these are all pictures taken in the zoo. So you have open grassy maidans. I think that's opposite, but that's in the elephant enclosure. And where you have birds like lapwings on the ground, swallows flying over. Click on that side. Yeah. Swallows flying over after the insects, warblers, partridges. If you come early, you can hear birds calling. A lot of birds call, the wild birds call. And you have to, bird watching is a two-pronged attack to learn your bird. One is of course visual sighting. The other, equally important I will say, is when you learn the calls of the bird. You can actually not see a single bird, but you can have a list of 30-40 species on your pad just by hearing the different calls. So partridges call, there might be two species of partridges. There are quail, which are the red quails called during monsoon, it's a lovely listen to them. Then you have the ponds. You know, there are several small water areas in the zoo which get covered with weeds, but they very picturesque. What do you need to do? You need to go and sit there, that's all. And the birds will keep seeing. You don't have to keep walking around the zoo or, you know, moving from point to point in an effort to maximize the species you see. It's not necessary. Your aim is to learn. If your aim is to learn, then you have to sit in a place and observe what goes on around you and write it down. Whatever you do, you must write it down, because those notes, when the thought process to the visual process gets transferred from the mind, from the eye to the mind to the hand, from the pen to the paper, it remains in your mind. If somebody tells you, this is a lapwing, that's a partridge, that's a rose bush, that's a XYZ, okay, they are there and you have forgotten about it. But if you write it down, if you see it, if you maybe photograph it, then it sticks in your mind and you will remember it throughout your life. So if we have these little ponds, which are habitats for herons, cormorants, ducks, I'm not showing many bird pictures. These are things, and bird books are available everywhere today. The zoo itself might have made several copies, which you should ask for and use when you are out in the field. I'm talking to you presuming that you are volunteers of the zoo corps and you do go out and you know help. So you may interact more with people who visit the zoo and learn yourself about the wildlife that is in the zoo. You may learn what is in the cages. You may learn about what is in the cages, how they live, what their names are, which countries they come from, what is fed to them, what is not fed to them, etc. But do you take time to learn what is not in the cages? That's what I'm trying to emphasize, that you must take time to learn what's not in the cages. And in the process of this talk, I want to bring around a project which you can easily do as a core and you know, help birds as well as the zoo in what you do. More habitats, you see they're all in the zoo, they're not taken exotically anywhere else outside our country or abroad. Reed beds, lotus and lily ponds. Please open your eyes and look around and you'll see all of this. And so many birds are attracted to that habitat. Bittern, those slim little things which you see, you don't see. But if you sit in one place, maybe you will see a leaf moving. Maybe you will see a reed moving or a lump on a leaf and, on a reed, and you wonder what is this. Everything is slim and... but there is a lump there, what is that? Then you see it, you know, bent over, downward, trying to fish. Painted snipe, where the male and the female are totally different, and the male is the one who takes up the work of the of raising the eggs and the young ones. Jacanas, with toes which are perhaps longer than their bodies, so that they can walk on leaves. And what is the principle? If they walk on lily leaves that are floating on the water, and they have toes which are that long, the principle is that, of course, the weight of the bird is spread over the toes and it doesn't sink. Because a single toe will just go down if it was standing, but otherwise it doesn't sink and it helps it. So in Ajapana, it sort of uses a habitat, a niche in a habitat, which is not used by other birds. How many birds do you see that are actually walking on leaves on water? The Ajapana, kingfishers. How many of you have seen kingfishers? Kingfishers are... you must be getting at least three species here, and there will be a different species where there is clear water, there will be a different species where the water is covered in vegetation, but it will be there. Then you have grass, one of the most beautiful of species according to me, plant life. When it flowers, when it is allowed to flower, as Mr. Tej Kumar said, most of the grass, most of the borders are actually cut before they flower. But if it is around to flower, this is in the zoo, one of the most visited areas in the zoo, and there also you see a lot of birds. You need to sit there to see what you've been missing on, you know, by not actually going and sitting there. In open water, fabulous place for birds, that fish and ducks. And here we see lots of migrants coming in winter. Migrant ducks have come in, and waders have also come in. This is just an absolutely the right place to create a small bird sanctuary. I wish there were more active zoo people here, but if they are not here, you can take it up with them and talk to them about it. A similar area in Ikrisat, in a dry year, was deepened. So what happened about the mud coming out? They piled it up in the center and made an island. Somebody they counted some trees. You will not believe the number of birds that have started nesting there. We got storks, we got ibises, we got cormorants, and we also got darters. They're all nesting there. And it's a smaller pond than this. So it can be done here also. We do get some birds, and there are a couple of dry trees there. But it's a very good habitat to attract more birds. Then of course the bamboo clumps in various areas of the zoo, they attract walkers and babblers. And you will think what are fallen leaves good for? What are dead trees good for? They should be cut, they are an eyesore, you know, they should be swept. But no, that's a habitat. There a lot of wildlife thrives. Not just lives, not just survives, but thrives. And we've got babblers, which are specialist feeders on the ground, which hop around, turn over leaves and pick up insects from under leaves. So, where leaves are piled up, leaves should be left alone and not swept away or burned periodically. They are a fire hazard, yes, but they can be managed. And in a small area like the zoo, they should be managed to promote bird life and insect life in the wider in the wilderness. This is a picture taken in front of the, I think, quarantine area for the tiger. Next. Then of course, even plant parasites like the Loranthus, the mistletoe, attract birds. And you won't believe there's a very little small bird called the flower pecker, the size of my thumb, one of the smallest of birds in India. And it feeds on this closed flower. How does it feed on it? Flower is closed. So the bird pinches it at the top and the flower springs open. And then it puts its beak inside and it takes the nectar. Again, good pollinators, birds are great pollinators of plants. And there are several hundred clumps of Loranthus in the zoo, I'm sure. And you will spend good time under one trying to watch birds and insects come. In flowers themselves, the zoo has several flowering trees and bushes, and they are great attractants, you know, they attract sunbirds and orioles and owls, all very colorful, all great songsters. All these birds, you can sit for minutes on end and just listen to an owl or a singer. You should be able to recognize, one way of recognizing which bird it is that is making a call is to follow the sound. You know, go and find out where the sound is coming from. That is essential, otherwise you will not see the bird. You have to do it. If you spend, I've spent half an hour, I've spent 40 minutes under a tree from which the sound is coming, I cannot see the bird. Ultimately you see it, maybe it flies away or something, you see it and then you will recognize it. Not able to recognize it, I'll tell you how you can you know, take down notes and things. So fruits of trees, even seed pods like that, when they break up and the seeds scatter, you'll see a lot of birds coming in. And of course the zoo is full of old, cherished old trees, lovely, you know, thick trunk, densely foliaged trees, which are full of birds. Large number of warblers, small birds migrate into India and they fill up the trees in December. You can go on, you know, just hearing them call, and you can make a list of the birds. And you can, every year if you are doing it, you can actually note when they have come, when you start hearing the call and when you last hear the call. So you know the seasonality, when they come in, when they go out. All these things you can do. So these are the various types of habitats which actually make the zoo so special in this and all these habitats exist. I don't think with much planning, with much interference from the management of the zoo. they must be doing some management, plant management, so that people are able to see what they have to display in cages and in moats. But otherwise, it just grows. And I would propose that if they actually manage the plants a little more, they might be able to attract more wildlife, actually wildlife into this. This is what I mean. Managing is a great responsibility. They have an area which is small, 380 acres, and it's not a forest of several thousand square kilometers or something. So a tree of that size, if it is cut, I'm sure the forester has given us, the zoo management have given a huge, a great deal of thought, you know, whether we should cut it or we should not cut it, why should we cut it, what are we doing, because a tree like that will take at least three generations to grow back to that size. It's very easy to cut down, but it's not so easy to create an environment that is, this I think they did it because they wanted bison to come into this enclosure, or maybe they were preparing it for giraffe, but they did it, and those were very trees, shade giving trees. This is a very old picture. Now this is what we used to do. A friend of mine spent 3 years coming twice every week to the zoo. Mr. Kulkarni is here, my good friend. Kulkarni and I used to come every week twice, and we each maintained a notebook in which we wrote what we did and what we saw. And Kulkarni used to go on one side of the road, I used to go on the one side, and we used to meet near the Singhosh Bund opposite the elephant enclosure. And it was truly an enlightening and revealing 2 or 3 years that we spent here. We learned so much. We may not have seen 200, 300 species because they didn't occur. But why did a bird behave in a certain way? What happened when, you know, it was attacked by a snake? So many observations came up. Now, you know, it's very simple. If you as a naturalist carry a pen and paper everywhere you go, you just have to note your own observations. Nobody will read those books, but they will be always available to you throughout your life if you want to refer to them. And you may not be able to draw a chick. Even like this, you may be maybe very rudimentary. What does a bird require to draw? And why do you need to draw it? Because when you draw it, when you mark the parts, they are there permanently fixed. If you draw it in your mind and you think, yes, when I go home I will do it. No, red might become orange, black might become brown. So things will differ, and when you look into a book, you will not be able to recognize your bird. So you draw whatever you can. You say, you know, the legs are horny grey, there's a dirty white breast patch, the bill is orange red, and it's the chick of a coot. Now if any one of you knows what a coot looks like, it doesn't look like a chick. Nor does the chick look like a parent. So, you know, unless you have seen them together, you wouldn't know if you saw this by itself, okay, what is that word? So you have to draw it down, and then you can write whatever, you know, like here it says young feeding individually. So they don't feed, there must be about 6 or 7 of them, but they don't feed together. They come out of the nest, they are quite precocious, they come out of the nest very soon after they hatch, because the nest is in the water and, you know, open, and it's liable to be preyed upon by so many other creatures. So they feed individually as well as are being fed by adults. 6 young are present, also bathing energetically and clambering onto rocks. Whatever you think is important, whatever interests you, whatever fascinates you, please note it down. It will come in use later on. Now black whale, these are birds. I don't know how good you are at work, identifying birds. If I name them, maybe it will be just a word to you. But black winged stick, one bird in non-breeding plumage. Okay, so birds change their plumage if they come in. Some of them change their plumage when they come into breeding, breeding plumage, or at the time of breeding, some don't. So if you see the plumage and you know it is changed, you know that the breeding season has started. That's how you record seasonality of birds. Now, sitting one day we saw a lesser whistling teal with young. Can you imagine the zoo as a breeding place for lesser whistling teal? We couldn't. We thought it was just, you know, very... It didn't have birds like that breeding here. But yes, and the lesser listening, the leader nests in the hole, in a hole, in large hole in a tree, which requires a really large old tree, or maybe in some secluded reed patch that people don't go. We couldn't think of a tree which was old and big enough, with a big enough hole for the bird to nest. It's perhaps they were nesting in the, on the ground in the reeds. But under we saw a bird with so many chicks, six chicks were there. It was quite an eye-opener. And then behavior of birds with each other. See, as you see, the mind gets ignited and you want to know why it is doing that, why the behavior is like that. You have to go back and read. We didn't have Google at that time. You have Google now, but be careful of Google because there's a lot of wrong information available also. There's a huge amount of right information, but unfortunately wrong information also is available. So, get to books if you can, go to libraries, come to the forest department or the Vanasthali where they have a good library. And do read up on what you see and, why a bird was bending down, why was it rearing up, why was it fluttering. Everything, every single thing can be relearned again and again. You may think that it has been said, that it is known, but you don't know it and you have not said it. So, for yourself, you must learn. You must learn every, you must question everything that is happening in the environment. Now, one day we were sitting and watching in 1991, nest of an Indian mohen, and this is what I wrote. I might bore you, but I'd like you to have patience with me and go through it. If 21 days hatching period is true, I had gone back and read about the mohen and how long it takes to breed. Then the chicks must have come out either on the 15th or 16th, most probably on the 15th. Three chicks were seen in reeds near one adult. It's not necessary to record near one adult, but the fact that the adult was there is important. On turning my glass, that is my binoculars, I am writing all this while sitting there. I can only do it because I am sitting there for 20 minutes, 30 minutes, going nowhere, but actually just sitting there. On turning my glass to the nest, you can form your own abbreviations for quick notes, N is nest. I was dismayed to see a 5-foot thaman roving around the nest. The thaman is a snake, rat snake. I had then not seen the three chicks in the water. I was about to write this nest off, but waited to see further developments. The snake climbed the bush from the water. Now this is a high drama, okay? If you are sitting bored there and suddenly you see a snake at the nest, something is going to happen. The snake climbed the bush from the water, then slid back into it from another side. When it was on the nest bush, one mohen, that is a parent, approached the nest bush quietly and hesitated to ascend the bush. Though it went to the approach branch repeatedly. Now what is an approach branch? A bird will approach a nest only along one or two roots. It will not fly directly to a nest because that's attracting your attention to the nest. So it will go and sit there, try and act as if ignoring you or ignoring the nest, and you go and sit in another place. And like this, indirectly it will reach a nest. So it went to the approach branch repeatedly. It was then that I noticed the snake on the nest. There was a bird already on the nest. Till the snake slid off the bush, the mohen remained close by. When it was totally in the water and had begun to swim towards some reeds in the western margin of the tank, the mohen followed closely by its side, uttering a short, sharp, urgent call. The mohen either pecked at the middle of the snake or even swam in front of it within 6 inches or a foot of its head, agitatedly vibrating its raised wings, uttering the strained alarm call. The snake was drawn by the movements and lunged at the bird. The bird has lured the snake away from its young by all this behavior. Okay, you may see it on TV, you may see it in movies. You may read about it, but seeing it actually happening in front of your eyes and knowing what's happening is the thrill of that, sitting in the wilderness and seeing what. Next, please. Now here I even drew a picture where the bird is in front of the snake and shaking its wings and trying to attract it away from there. And here is the bush with the nest. The bush is without leaves, it's completely only twigs, so the nest is very visible and the snake going in and out. And 2 days later, I again went to write down that the family is safe and the young are not there. I mean, the snake is not there, etc. This was another observation about behavior of spot filters, the aggressive behavior or whatever. And so, you know, keep a notebook, keep writing in it whenever you see something. What another thing we do is when we go bird watching, if you see a bird, you write the name of the bird, and you try and estimate how many they are. If they are in a flock, you say, okay, there are 80 or 80 plus, 80 minus. So that also builds up over time, and you have a record. If you are doing it every month in the zoo, walk around census, and you see cotton tails on the water 5 one time, 10 one time, 30 or 40 another time. And over 2-3 years, you or your group has maintained these records, then you have a census over 3-4 years about the population in the zoo. Next page. I'm sorry, I think this is the last one of these slides. There is a migrant which comes, a small flycatcher called a red-breasted or a red-throated flycatcher, and they fill up the zoo in the winter. Very territorial birds fighting for their territory. One might have a territory which is this big, one might have that big. And you can sit in a place and actually observe 3 or 4 birds fighting for their territory, where, you know, they come close to each other and they demonstrate in some way when, you know, they are interacting, and one goes to his, one comes back. And you can see that, you know, you can actually plot a territory. And this is what happened here when there were 3 birds interacting. And then ultimately A went, I called them ABC. So one went one side and you can plan out. Over just 1 year, Kulkarni and I were able to tell friends, now we are coming to an area where you will see a notice in front of the enclosure. On the notice, you will see this bird. You get so familiar with the environment. And the birds, I mean, you are coming every time, and you are not disturbing them. So they just behave normally and do what they wish to do. But you are able to judge which birds are there next. Okay. You can impress your friends that way. During our time bird watching in the zoo, we saw several species which we consider uncommon. Only uncommon from the point of view that the zoo is set in the midst of so much of humanity. But the habitat in the zoo attracts these birds. Maybe as a point they stop at before on their roads from one place to the other, or they are attracted for, or as a feeding place for that one night or 2 nights because of the rich habitat that the zoo has. So we've seen the Eurasian hobby, a migrant once. We were bird watchers watching near the, again, the water body in front of the elephant enclosure, and this bird came and said, "Oh, you can just see opposite." But we saw it, and we were able to identify with the help of Rajiv, which is my good friend Rajiv Matthew, who said it's a hobby. I thought it was a peregrine, but it's a note smaller and it's a hobby. It was actually a hobby. Very rare migrant, and you know, just, it was just a matter of chance that the bird watchers were there that day, and we were able to record it for this part of the country. Comb ducks, it's a resident of India. But and the comb, this knob on the beak is called the comb. The male has it, the female, the duck doesn't have it, the drake has it. We've seen it in the zoo a couple of times. I think they just come because, you know, traveling from maybe country fair or somewhere, and they see the zoo and they stop it. Glossy ibis, not that common, again a resident, but spotted in the zoo. Now the chestnut-tailed starling is a relative of the myna, as you can see it, and it's a winter migrant here. Very quiet bird and very interesting to observe. You'll see lots of them around, again, that same area, elephant enclosure and the trees that are planted all along the road. The bay hornbill is not so rare, but I consider it, you know, unique because it prefers large trees, and the zoo does provide that cover and the food, etc. And with all the huge trees that line the highways till recently, those trees have been cut because the highways have been broadened, and which is also necessary. But they had this property, and those trees are generally fixed, your people, your fighters. And they invariably harbored grey hornbills. Most of them have moved into the city, and you see lots of grey hornbills in the city now. The weavers, again, birds that come, and two species of weavers come and nest in the zoo on reeds or on trees. This is one which nests, makes a nest and which hangs from reeds in the water. Next, please. So this is the jacana I was talking about. There are two species, both are found in the root. This is a bronze wing. The other one is with the feathered tail, which is whitish in color and has a long tail. So you can see the toes of the bird and you can see where it is standing. Literally walking on water, if you didn't know what it was doing. This is the painted snipe that I spoke about. And that is the lesser whistling duck with young one photographed in the zoo. Next, please. The pitta is a local migrant in India. Local migrant means it only migrates within India and moves along with a monsoon. You see it here sometimes. The wood shrike is an insect specialist, and you know, you can hear it more often than you can see it. The cuckoo shrike also is an insect and nectar specialist, and along with the minivet, it's a very attractive. This is a female. The male has a black head here. So they move together and their call is very attractive. Now, I've spoken about habitats, I've spoken about the type of birds you can see. What can you do as, you know, people who want to, who are interested in nature, who perhaps want to hone your skills to become better naturalists? I've found that the best way to go about is to study what you see. And by study, it is not, you know, late night study when you're hunting off for exam. But you've got these lovely books which are available in English. Of course, there are several types of books are available. But even in Telugu, even in the local language, we have world-class guides which you can borrow if you don't know Telugu or English. And you can, you know, identify the birds here. They have information about the life histories of the bird, where it is found in India. If we are going to design a program of simple censusing birds in the zoo, then a checklist of this type where you have a list of all the birds that you are supposed to, that you are liable to see in the zoo, and you can, you know, just pick them. That we call them on this day. If these squares represent a day, these columns represent a day each, then you know the first week, second week, third week. And you have this one card, maybe in 15 weeks, data right in front of you. So these are the tools that you will require for bird watching. That's all. I consider essential a notebook and a pencil. Now I even consider a binoculars essential. Even if you don't have a field guide, till you know maybe a month or two into bird watching, serious bird watching, it doesn't matter. Just keep on writing what you see. Say you saw a green colored bird sitting on a wire, trying to catch an insect, beating the insect on the wire to kill it, swallow it with a long tail. And if you don't know what it is, but you come to a bird book after a month or 2 months or 6 months, I'm sure you will be able to identify what that bird is. Is anybody able to tell me what it is offhand? No. But you go ahead and do such things. When you write it down, it will stick in your mind and you will be able to identify. I'm sorry, it's not a clear slide, but I just wanted to show that in the zoo, 56 families of birds I have been able to, we have been able to watch and identify, and of which 173 species are found. So you can, you know, just want to specialize, okay, if the oriole interests you, just go and study the oriole all the time. If the hornbill interests you, fine, just do that. People didn't know that the color of the hornbill's eye, the male and the female, differ. But only if you watch and you realize that, okay, and you are reading also what has been recorded and you see that it's not been recorded earlier, always feel free to write about it. Write to a journal, write to a magazine, not a political magazine or something, but there are scientific magazines which publish articles. Write to them, and if the editors feel that yes, you have a unique note to contribute, your note, your article, your paper will be published and it will add to the scientific knowledge of the world. Never underestimate your own observations and your own ability to communicate to the world. Never feel that you are, you know, small, as they say, or you are unable to do it. People will not consider. They will consider. It will get into the. We have all done it. Next day. I don't think this is clear, but this was a very interesting chart I was able to make, where I started bird watching in 1981. And every year, every new species that I saw was added gradually to it. So in the first year, I saw 82 species. In 82, I saw 31 more further new species. And it went down to in 87, I didn't see any new species. I thought that perhaps I had all the birds that come to the zoo, I have seen here. But again, you know, over the years, I saw more new species. And actually, this year, we saw four species here which I had never seen earlier in the zoo. So there is no end to learning. There is no end to thinking that yes, you know it all. Never. Nature will always bring a surprise on you, and you will definitely see something new, something interesting. Now, the zoo has been a hub for conservation also in a way, where endangered animals and birds have been brought to the zoo either because they were injured for treatment or, you know, they were captured somewhere and they couldn't be released. There are some tragically endangered birds in today's world which came to the zoo. One is the Great Indian Bustard. This bird was shot near Karnool and brought to the zoo in 1982. It did not survive. One of the reasons it did not survive could be that the injury could not be cured by the vets because they didn't know how to cure it. Veterinary science, after all, is on domestic animals. They don't learn on wild animals, and they have to, you know, make do, they have to fall back on. And in the 80s, there was no internet, they didn't know how to contact the other regions in the world where buskards are found, maybe the Middle East, etc. So this poor animal was fed banana. And I think it choked on the banana because it's unpalatable, it's not its food, and it died. Then there was this, again the same family of buskards, the lesser florican, very rare. Perhaps it hit a wire or something. But the zoo had a very good taxidermist, a person who's able to stuff dead animals into either skin, museum skins, or into mount them into like you see the dioramas in the National Museum. And this bird was stuffed and it was given over to the department. The vulture, the Cinereus vulture, was not known from Andhra Pradesh, but a bird was captured in Karimnagar and brought in 86 to the zoo, and it was added to the zoo. And so you see, the zoo is a place where it's like an oasis for such birds or such animals or such incidents, where people can only think, hey, what to do with it, we don't know how to care or take care of it. So let's take it and give it to the zoo. There will be some people there who will take care of it. And the zoo, I must say, has, since it is a leading light, since it is one of the best, one of the top three zoos in the country, you know, when I started coming to the zoo, I read an article in a magazine which I got from the zoo. They used to get lovely wildlife magazines from all over the world. And this was called The Natural History, published by the American Museum of Natural History. And there was an article that I opened to which said the best zoo in the world. And will you believe it? It was the NZP. It was this zoo which that man, the curator from an American American organization, came and he said he thinks it is the best zoo in the world. Thankfully, NZP still, in my heart, it still holds the same thing. It's one of the best zoos in the country. And there used to be a huge mat in front of the gate, which is not there now, which used to be squelchy with phenyl, you know, so that it was meaningless. But, you know, just the thought that even the people who come in should have shoes, etc., which are cleaned out, you know, before they step in. So if you walked in, you had to walk through the squelchy phenyl filled mattress and go in and clean your feet. That was the idea then. Then the spot-bellied eagle owl, a recent addition to the Andhra Pradesh list from the Eastern Ghats as well. As it was caught in the Eastern Ghats, we didn't know it existed in the country. It was caught as a youngster by some tribal boys, and for some reason it couldn't be released back into the wild. It was unable to fly, and it was brought in, and I think it's still in the nocturnal animal house and grown into an adult. Now this, Jordan's possum, you know, it is the most endangered species in the world. It is found only in Andhra Pradesh, only in Karma, which makes us extremely responsible for this world. As you can see, it's a classic throwback to an ancient time, and by ancient I mean several million years ago, when India was joined to Africa in one huge continent called the Brahmanas. And the way, see, animals can show you how a country is drifted apart, because this bird, its cousins are still found in Africa. I mean, two birds cannot spontaneously arise in some different regions completely unconnected with each other. They might be similar type of bird, but related to each other, no. So the other porcelains are there in Africa, and their survival are the Jordan's porcelain. And it is found only in Karpa, as I said. It's a nocturnal bird that comes out and is active in the night. And it is so rare that people have hardly seen it. It was rediscovered maybe after 92 years or something. And the man who was responsible for bringing the zoo to what it is, Mr. Pushpa Kumar, was, I think, in charge of wildlife at the time. And N.T. Rama Rao had just come up as a politician and leader of political parties in Madhya Pradesh, and he had this dream of the Telugu Ganga. And unfortunately, the Telugu Ganga went through the area where the Jordan's porcelain had been discovered that year. So Mr. Pushpa went and said in a meeting that, sir, it goes through the area where the Jordan's porcelain is found, and it should be, you know, diverted. Its course should be there. So NTR was extremely appalled. He said, what is this? You are talking about a little bird and you are talking about water to hundreds and thousands of Telugu. So Pushpa Kumar, not to be let down ever, got up and said, sir, it is the pride of Telugu. He said, what? A small bird like this is the pride of Telugu? He said, yes, because it is found only in Andhra Pradesh. It's not found anywhere in the world. NTR, to all his credit, had the sense actually divert the camera. So, but today the bird is extremely endangered. That whole area has been overrun by commercial agriculture, some lime plantations have come up, etc. And the bird has not been sighted. There's a research team from the BNHS that is constantly there. It's not been sighted in the past 5 or 6 years. Even the call has not been heard. So I think the zoo could be a place where the bird might be reared and captive. In the future, if the permission is given, because it is rare, you see the problem here, because it is there, you can't capture it, you can't do anything because it might die. But without doing that, it will not anyway survive. It's overrun with people, it's overrun with cattle, it's overrun with plantations. Imagine a bird. This will perhaps be the first extinction in India in over a century or so, if it dies out. They may be about between 8 to 15 or 20 birds alive. It can still be brought back from the brink, but you know the government has to make that extra effort. And places like the zoo are where it can actually be done. Next week. So this was actually meant for the zoo management. When I said that a paradigm shift in perspective is required in a zookeeper to see the wilderness within the boundaries of a zoo, one that metamorphoses, that is, changes the zookeeper into a naturalist. There is no better place than the wonderful, indeed life-changing, neurological park for the magic of wilderness to work on future generations. I wish the NZP another glorious 50 years. The last one you didn't show. Just go to the last slide. And then you can go down with it. After that, the last one. Lots of people helped me put this presentation together. I'd like to thank all of them. Anand Ki and Anand M. Asif Zain, Geetanjali Dhar. Of course, we couldn't play the call of the Ola payment. Then I downloaded that map from Google Earth. Then our watching friends, Mayan Tahar, Nishant Shah, Prashant Mahesan, Satyanarayana Srinivasan and Simon Cook. Thank you very much.